It's a popular saying that musicians die, but their music will live on forever. Well, this statement clearly describes Uganda's musical legend, Jimmy Katumba, commonly described as the Black Jim Reeves. In our special report tonight, as we mark 15 years since his death in 2006 at Mengo Hospital, we take a look back at his musical journey through the lenses of a renowned music critic, Joseph Pate. He talks about his life and the times of Jimmy Katumba and how he influenced the Ugandan music industry. Take a look.
Jimmy Katumba was a popular Ugandan musician. He started out as a singer of gospel music in the early years and rose to fame as the country's pop star from the late 1970s to the 1990s. Katumba helped shape popular music in Uganda and has earned a place among the country's leading musicians and the greatest of all time. Today marks exactly 15 years since he passed away, but his music is still with us, reminding us of the power of talent in transforming society. Music lovers born after the 1990s might not be familiar with his works. So who exactly is Jimmy Katumba? We spoke to Joseph Bate, a popular music critic.
Jimmy Katumba was a talented singer. That's what I know about him. He had that baritone voice, and he was copying Jim Reeves, an American singer called Jim Reeves. Jimmy Katumba, he was born in 1955, and he died at the age of 51 at Mengo Hospital.
Like many other musicians, Katumba equally belonged to a music group. So how and when did he start singing?
Jimmy Katumba started singing at the age of 8 as an alto in Mukono Church of Uganda. That's where his father, Blasio was a preacher there, the reverend there, Blasio was there. And in the choir, Jimmy Katumba, young Jimmy Katumba, sang in the choir, started out as an alto. And then when the voice broke, he moved from alto to bass. And then the turning point came in 1973 when he was studying.
For those that lived in Uganda in the 1970s and 80s, it was a bad year for music. Those were the dark days of Pandagari. But how did Jimmy Katumba and the Ebonies survive that time?
They avoided politics. So you listen to most of the recordings, actually recordings back in the day, none of the musicians would dare sing about politics because you would pay either with your life or end up in prison. And he didn't, they avoided it, but in 1983 he goes to Tanzania. and is asked by President Julius Nyerere to sing Chama Cha Mapinduzi.
For those born in the 21st century, Jimmy Katumba's music is not popular. Tell us, how did his art impact the country?
Yeah, 76. They changed the name to from the light, Jimmy Katumba and the Light Bearers to Jimmy Katumba and the Ebonies. And what follows after that, oh my God, a lot of good music. The band, they were, you know, that acting, that live stage performances and stuff like that. They were really good, very, very good, Jimmy Katumba, especially the voice. And the church harmonies and the, you know, the sweet melodies. We loved it so much. And that people started copying. Choirs started copying this Jimmy Katumba styles. Songwriters started copying the way he sang. And that's how he influenced the music industry in Uganda.
Joseph Bate was lucky to be among the last people to have interacted with Jimmy Katumba before he passed away in 2006. Did Katumba have any plans of bettering the music industry before he died?
Our last interview when I met him, his legs were swollen. His face was bloated, but he was in pain. He poured his heart out, and I remember that time that he even cried. He cried. I could not also hold it. I saw myself, you know, crying at the same time because he was really in pain. He was looking back at his career. He was a poor man. He didn't have a good house. He didn't have a good car. He was like really devastated. He was disappointed with himself, with the career, how it ended. But he was not giving up. You say, oh, he was a very, very humble man. He was he's a gentleman. He behaved like a black brutal.
When Katumba recovered from an 8-hour coma, he asked his relatives and friends who were gathered around his bed, if you were in my situation, what would you do? His last words were, let me turn to my God.